Good evening. We are so grateful that you are here with us this evening and have chosen to celebrate God's faithfulness to Covenant College by providing us with a new president. Please take this time, just a couple of reminders, to turn off any device that might distract us from our experience of this concert as a community. Also, just note where the exits are in the building in case of an emergency. For your information, there are restrooms downstairs or backstage via this hallway right here. Also, please note in the program the desire for your participation during most of the songs. You will find song selections in the program or on the screen behind me. Please sing as directed or by either the conductor or the chapel team leaders, and there are asterisks when you are being asked to stand. Just a reminder too, immediately following the concert, we would love to invite you to join us for a dessert reception in the Great Hall, just north of us here, this direction. It's freely offered as Covenant College's gift to you and to your families. We are so glad you are here. We have so many reasons to respond in gratitude and celebration because of what our triune God has done and is doing. So let's pray as we begin rejoicing together. Heavenly Father, we come tonight with hearts full of praise and gratitude and wonder at your work here at Covenant College. Lord, we do not boast in our own works, but we come to celebrate your faithfulness, your love for us. And Father, we pray tonight that as we remember your faithfulness to this place, we would walk out encouraged to continue to trust you more each day. You have never failed us, and you will never fail us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Responsive reading of Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine upon us, that your ways may be known on earth, your salvation among all nations. May the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. May the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you rule the peoples justly and guide the nations of earth. May the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. Then the land will yield its harvest, and God, our God, will bless us. God will bless us, and all the ends of the earth will fear him.
Thank you. Now would you join me in a responsive reading of Psalm 130 and Psalm 131. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice.
Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I put my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning.
O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption.
He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins.
My heart is not proud, O Lord. My eyes are not haughty.
I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me.
But I have stilled and quieted my soul.
Like a weaned child with his mother, like a weaned child is my soul within me.
O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forevermore.
Thank you. Without question, the most straight-up Ben-Hur hymn I have ever had the privilege to sing with brothers and sisters. I've been asked this evening to reflect for a few moments on celebrating faithfulness. And what I'd like to do is begin with, really it's a story, but if you'll take it as such, sort of a living poem about God's love for us. There's a Roman Catholic priest named Greg Boyle, and he serves in the Boyle Heights area of Los Angeles, one of the most dangerous and gang-infested areas in our country. During his first year after his ordination, he served in Cochabamba, Bolivia, up in the mountains. He was learning Spanish, and he was serving there for a year. A short time after he had been there, some health workers asked him if he'd be willing to go up into the mountains to a little mountain village called Tirani and to do a service there for the Quechua Indians. They hadn't had a minister for 10 years there in their village. He said he'd be glad to do that. So he jumped in the back of a truck one morning, an open-air truck with a number of other folks, and up they went. And Tirani is high up in the mountains in Bolivia. It's a little town, a village, and their primary output is flowers. So it would not be uncommon to see Tirani villagers walking down the mountain with loads of flowers on their backs, taking them to the village markets to sell. So about halfway up the mountain, Greg looks into his backpack just to make sure he has all of his stuff. Like I said, his Spanish is not good. He's newly ordained, and he realizes that he doesn't have the church service with him. And he begins to sweat, and he thinks, oh goodness, what am I going to do? His Spanish is not really good enough to do this off the fly. So he grabs his Bible and he begins thinking, oh, which passages should I do? Where should I read? They go up, they get up into the village, and a big field has been cleared, and there are hundreds of Quechua Indians there waiting for him. So he's going to do the service, and somebody is going to interpret for him. And the way that he describes it when he's talking about it is, I don't remember a single word that I said, but I know that it was very, very bad. After the service was over, people began to disperse, and a health worker brought over an old woman and said, would you be willing to listen to this old woman? She hasn't gone to confession in 10 years. He said, I'd be glad to. So she began to talk, and he couldn't understand a word she was saying, but she spoke for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15, 20, 30 minutes goes by, and eventually she finishes, and he prays for her, and she walks away. And he looks around and realizes he's the only person there. Everyone has left. The mental health workers are gone. The truck is gone. So he throws his backpack over his shoulder, and he begins the trek down the mountain. And as he's walking, he sees this lone man start to walk up to him, ancient in appearance. He's wearing old woolen pants with a rope belt to tie them on. He's got on a white linen shirt that's frayed at the collar. He has on an old suit coat that's three sizes too large and falling apart. He's got an old fedora sitting on his head. He's got on open-toed sandals, and his feet are caked with mud. And his face has wrinkles and crevices in every possible place you could imagine. And he walks up, and he stops Greg, and he says, Tatai, gracias por haber venido. Thanks for coming. And then he reaches his hands into his pockets, and he pulls out of his pockets rose petals, white, pink, red, yellow, and he lifts them up, and he signals for Greg to lean down. Greg's a big guy. He's a tall man. So Greg leans down, and the old man drops the rose petals over Greg's head, and they begin to fall. And he reaches back into his pockets, and he does it again. And he reaches back into his pockets, and he does it again. And at this point, Greg is looking down at the ground, And there are rose petals falling all over the ground, and his tears, because he's weeping now, are falling into the rose petals. And the fragrance of the roses is coming up, and the old man empties out his pockets, every last rose petal on Greg's head, puts his hands back in his pockets, and turns and walks away. Greg said, "I was convinced that a worst priest never visited this place or walked this earth. And this old man came and showered the love of God upon him." Now, friends, a more wretched sinner never walked this place, never walked this earth, is something that each and every one of us could say. Yet the love of the Father envelops us with a fragrance far more beautiful than what Greg smelled that day. You are loved by God. We are loved by God. And I'd like for you to hold that for just one moment. And I'm going to shift gears to what I think is one of the most beautiful and perhaps clearest expressions of God's faithfulness in the scriptures. And I'd like you to notice, I'm intentionally not defining faithfulness, but I'd like you to do it. Perhaps this evening when you go home, perhaps tomorrow, think about faithfulness and see if you can define it. What is this thing? In Genesis chapter 15, God has promised Abram descendants and land. And the descendants, he says, "Abram, look up at the stars in the sky, count them if you can." He looks up, and Abram believes that God is going to fulfill his promise. And with the land that God is going to give them to possess, Abram says, "But Lord, how can I know? How can I know that you're going to give us this land?" And the Lord tells Abram, "Go and get a heifer and a goat and a ram and some birds and come back." And he gives him instructions. He cuts the animals in half, and he creates a literal pathway of blood with the animals cut in half in each part and the birds whole sitting up at the top. They're sitting out, and what this is, there's a very clear expectation for about what's going to happen next. The next thing that's going to happen is Abram is going to walk through those animals. And the reason Abram is going to walk through is because this is part of a suzerain vassal treaty. It's a part of a treaty that a great king makes with a smaller ruler of a household or a small plot of land. And that great king makes out the establishment of the treaty. What are going to be the punishments if you're not faithful to uphold your end of the bargain? And then the smaller ruler walks through saying that if I ever break any of the covenant that we're making together, then what has befallen these animals will befall me. But instead, something very different happens. In theophanic glory, the presence of the living God comes in a smoking fire pot and a blazing torch, and God himself walks through those animals, promising and covenanting upon himself that he will take the punishment if his people ever break the covenant. His passage through those animals is a foreshadowing of the cross of Jesus Christ, where Jesus takes on himself the punishment for every infraction of the broken covenant between the sons of Abram, us, sons of Abraham by faith in the living God, and the Lord. The faithfulness is shown in great splendor here, our Lord's faithfulness. But that faithfulness of God courses through the Bible at every single turn. He was faithful to a husband and a wife who were charmed by a snake. He was faithful to a very old man and a very old woman who became parents for the first time. He was faithful to a swindling brother who stole his brother's inheritance and later took up wrestling. He was faithful to an adopted Egyptian who didn't speak so well. He was faithful to a giant-killing, murderous adulterer, to a prostitute who hung a scarlet cord from the window of her family's home. He was faithful to a lovely young woman who was born for such a time as this. He was faithful to a young engaged couple on the cusp of divorce because she was pregnant. He was faithful to a thief hanging next to him who he promised to see very soon. And you could go on and on and insert every single one of our names into that list. He is faithful. He is faithful. He is faithful. Our God is a faithful God by virtue of his character, by virtue of his very being. And we are grateful that it is a faithfulness that we can cling to at all times and in all circumstances. But now I'll explain why I started with the story that I did. It's because we're here to celebrate God's faithfulness. The reason that we can celebrate God's faithfulness is because it is a faithfulness born of and anchored in love for his people. Faithfulness apart from love is honorable. But faithfulness born of and anchored in love is God faithfulness. That's divine faithfulness. It's the faithfulness that causes the psalmist to cry out, "The Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." And that is why we celebrate. He is faithful to provide because he loves us and he cares for us as his children. He is faithful to be with us and to never leave us because he loves us and wants to be in our midst. And back to Abram, he is faithful to die in our place, the perfect sacrifice for his alienated children, because he loves us and desires us to know him, to be with him, to glorify him. He has been and is faithful to Covenant College. He is faithful to bring in and send out amazing students. He is faithful to gather professors and staff who love him and love our students to fulfill her mission. He is faithful to raise up leaders to guide and steward and shepherd. He is faithful to sustain us and carry us and be our hope today and tomorrow. And we should never forget that he is faithful to Covenant College because he loves her and because he loves his people. Amen. Amen.
Jesus, high and exalted, my eyes are fixed upon his face. It shines like the sun. I can see Jesus clothed in glory. He is high and lifted up, and his train fills the temple, and all of the
Thank you. to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name, tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the people in his faithfulness.
We still have a few songs to sing together, so please stand and sing with us. We're going to start with In Christ Alone. It's pretty straightforward, and the ending is just a little bit different.
So my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. Why heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, which drive.
six cents. Let's sing together. Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. Amazing grace.
Wow. Can we give God praise for an amazing job? Thank you, guys. Praise be to God. Wow. Just a moment, I'm going to close us in prayer, but I have some instructions before I do. Thank you for taking the time to celebrate with us here at Covenant College. It is a joy to host all of you, and I speak on behalf of our board. Please do join us for the reception. Just walk in that direction, make your way to Carter Lobby, and then to the Great Hall. Now, in just a moment, we'll be joining and singing an arrangement of All for Jesus that will be supported by our chapel teams and our orchestra. This is a new arrangement. It features a refrain and a modified groove that supports the Highland Cathedral tune from Scotland. Now, never fear, tomorrow we'll close our ceremonies with the traditional version of this hymn with organ. So be here for that in the morning. But meanwhile, let's enjoy as we celebrate with our college hymn that we are seeking to teach our multi-generational community how important both tradition and accessibility are as worshipers of one eternal King. Let's go to that King in prayer together. Lord, we do give you thanks, for you are good. Your steadfast love endures forever. Thank you, God, that we've gotten to sing that. Thank you for the reminder from the Word of God tonight that not only are you a faithful God, but it is a loving faithfulness. It's a divine faithfulness, and so we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for this tangible demonstration that we celebrate tonight. Lord, you have been so good to Covenant College. All through our history, Lord, you have raised up just the right men that you had in mind for the time to lead this university. And Lord, again, you have done it. You are so faithful. You have raised up Dr. Brad Voiles. Thank you for he and Kelly, because you have raised them up for such a time as this. We thank you for this tangible display of your faithfulness and how that faithfulness will continue to be displayed as we go forward into a very bright future. Lord, we thank you because you're able. Lord, you are able to do immeasurably more than all we might ask or imagine. And it's not according to us, but it's according to your power that's at work within us, our faithful God. And so to you be glory and power and honor and might and strength, for you indeed are a faithful God whose steadfast love endures forever. We give you praise in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and all his people said, amen. Amen.
Jesus, all for Jesus.